Hey everyone, my name is Seth Persigel, callsign KK4TEE, and today I'll be demonstrating how to create a drive-by-wire script for rovers in Kerbal Space Program. I'm sure at some point we've all tried to build a rover, only to find out that they frequently want to flip over if you go just a little bit too fast. And even if you manage to keep them under control, you have to constantly adjust the speed by holding the W or S key the whole time you're driving. In this video, we're going to fix that. The program will focus on three things. First, using a proportional integral controller to regulate the rover's speed. Second, reducing steering input the faster the rover goes. And third, steering the rover on a user-defined heading. When the program starts, it will default to a cruise control setting of 0. To start moving, turn the brakes off and press the W key, just like normal. Keep holding the W key until the target speed indicator is set to the speed you want. kOS will now adjust the motors to automatically maintain that speed. If you try to steer using the A or D keys, kOS will also automatically dampen the input based on the speed the rover is going. So the faster you go, the wider it corners. As you can see, this keeps the rover firmly planted on the ground. Now that we're pointing where we want to go, press the 2 key to lock in the heading, and the 1 key to toggle on the autopilot. The rover will now stay pointing on the heading and rove at the set speed. If the rover starts going too fast, kOS will reduce the power to the wheels, or even run them backwards in order to slow down. If you need to change the heading, you can tap 3 or 4 to increment the target heading by half a degree. If you need to make a large adjustment, use the 5 or 6 key to start the counter moving quickly. It will continue to adjust the target heading until you tap the 5 or 6 key again. To stop the system at any time, just turn on the brakes by pressing the B key or the icon next to the altimeter. Turning the brakes on will automatically set the target speed to 0. When you're ready to end the program, tap the 0 key. You can also end any kOS program by having the terminal selected and pressing and holding Ctrl C. Now that I've gone over the features, let's go over the code that makes it all happen. We'll start by setting up the program very similarly to the programs in the previous videos. Just as before, the variables we are likely to tweak or change go at the top. Here we have the speed limit variable, which will be the fastest speed we allow the rover to go. Following that is the turn limit, which I have based on a fraction of the surface speed. These pair of variables should be tuned for the specific rover you design, but the values here should get you started. The next section sets up the proportional integral controller that handles the throttle. I'll explain how these work when we get deeper into the code, but for now just know that because of the way our loop works, we need to initialize or declare all of the variables before we start using them. Initializing is done so that if a variable, such as the one for cumulative error, is read before it has useful data added to it, it will return a zero instead of being left undefined. Following these variables, we have the usual SAS off, RCS off, etc. We'll set action group 10 to end the program by making the run mode equal -1, which will stop the main until loop. The needs of the script are relatively simple, so it only has a single run mode. It contains all of the logic to take the input from the user and modify it before sending it to the rover's steering and motor outputs. First, we'll deal with the throttle for the wheels. kOS lets you set different values for each of the different ways to control a ship in KSP, such as a throttle for the rocket engines, the amount of force for the RCS thrusters to translate, and even which way to steer just the wheels without spinning the reaction wheels or engine gimbals. Using the controls in this way is called raw control, because the script has to explicitly state the actions, such as how long and how hard to steer the ship to the left. To update the cruise control variable, we first take whatever the cruise control was set to in the previous loop and add a fraction of what the pilot is inputting. Ship control pilot wheel throttle returns 1 if you are pressing W and -1 if you are pressing S, or some value in between those two if you happen to be using a joystick. Next, we'll use a set of min-max functions to clamp down the value for the target speed to be between -1 and the speed limit. Next up is to use the proportional integral controller if the target speed is above 0 meters per second. The first step is to figure out the error between the target speed and the current surface speed. Next, we integrate it together. Put simply, this means we add up the errors from the previous loops with the error from this loop, so that kOS remembers how far off it has been in the past. It's a good idea to put bounds on this value so that the responsiveness is kept relatively high. In our case, there's no reason to record more error than the motors are capable of outputting. That said, it's still important for the loop to know how long the error has been there, so we multiply the current loop's error by the loop time, which is how long it takes for kOS to go through the main loop before starting over. All of this is then added together to form the user variable WTVal, aka the wheel throttle value. After this, we run a check to see if the vehicle is going at a slow speed. If it is, I clamp down the value to reduce the amount of reverse power that the wheels are allowed to output. This helps to reduce the odds of the rover accidentally rolling backwards when we actually want it to go forwards. The next else-if evaluation checks to see if the rover is supposed to be traveling backwards. If it is, the throttle is set to the pilot's input and the target speed is reset to zero. For simplicity, while going backwards, the pilot has manual control over the motors. This is because surface speed only returns an absolute value, so it's not a simple task to figure out if the rover is going forwards or backwards. In a later video, I'll show you how to figure that out. Wrapping up the else if statements, we use else to catch any values outside of the above ranges, i.e. zero. If this is the case, the wheel throttle is set to zero and the brakes are turned on. Finally, we use a separate if statement to check if the brakes are currently on, and if they are, the target speed is reset to zero. With the throttle taken care of, we can finally move on to the steering controls. Steering is usually handled manually by the rover pilot, but if Action Group 1 is activated, the rover will steer towards the programmed target heading on its own. To do this, the error steering variable is used to track how far the current heading is off from the target heading. Because we are working with degrees, we have to do a little bit of conditional math to know whether to steer left or right. If the error is ever more than 180 degrees out, we'll flip it so that it is going the other way around. Thus, 190 degrees left becomes 170 degrees right. The bright side of dealing with this is that we can then pipe the positive or negative error value directly into the steering controls. It'd be a little twitchy, but it would get the job done. That said, we can clean it up a little bit first, so that the next step is to take the positive or negative value and attenuate it down to a value small enough for the rover's steering wheel to work with. So we'll clamp it to a value between 1 and negative 1, and then multiply it by the turn limit to keep the rover from flipping over. After that, all we have to do for steering is to handle what to do if Action Group 1 is not active. Since the user-commanded turn value already comes from KSP as a value between negative 1 and 1, all we have to do is multiply it by the turn limiter. Easy peasy. The next part of the script takes the input from the user in the form of which action groups are being pressed. We covered this earlier, so I'm going to skip down to the target heading checks. These are again used for dealing with degrees. If the user is using an action group to change the target heading, and it happens to go above 360 degrees or below 0 degrees, then the script flips the value to the opposite of the one it just crossed, just like a needle on the compass would. If neither of these conditions are met, the value is kept as is. At this point, we're just about done. The control values are finally written from our variables to the actual rover throttle and steering wheel. Then we just print some useful data to the screen and reset the loop time variables. Keep in mind that when dealing with PID controllers, it's extremely useful to keep an up-to-date loop time value so that the program knows how much to multiply the values by. For example, if the program runs 5 times per second, it can divide the error in speed by that much. Likewise, if the loop is running slow, it can automatically increase the error and try to compensate. PID controllers are simple in concept, but can take a lot of tinkering to get right. If you'd like to learn more about them, check out one of the links on the screen or do a search about it. Control theory is really quite fascinating. Now that we're finished with the rover script, I'd like to know your thoughts and if there's a specific subject you would like me to cover. If there is, please leave it in the comments below. As always, thank you for watching, and this is Seth Persigel, signing off.